Good morning.
It
is good to see you all this morning. Thank you for being with us here in worship at Bethel today. I'd like to read two verses out of the Psalms. It's the entire chapter. Psalm 117 is only two verses long, but they are great in directing our hearts toward God and directing us in worship. So listen to Psalm 117. Praise the Lord, all nations. Extol him, all peoples. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Aren't you thankful that God's faithfulness is not like mine or yours or anyone else's? That he is always faithful. It doesn't matter the day, the time, the year. God is always faithful. So let's go to him this morning and ask him to be faithful in our midst as we worship him today, that he would be glorified and lifted up, and that he would do a great work within us. Join with me in that prayer. God, thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship you today. God, we know intellectually, in our minds, we know that your faithfulness endures forever. But God, I just pray that you would help us to just pause for a moment and to consider how faithful you are. Lord, in every circumstance of life, in all of creation, God, in your character, you are always the same yesterday, today, and forever. That God, in your character and who you are, Lord, you are perfect in all of those ways. Lord, in your might, in your power, in your providence, in your love, in your justice, in your forgiveness, God, you are perfect. Lord, help our eyes and our hearts be directed toward you this morning as we worship. God, I pray that Jesus would be exalted here at Bethel today through songs that are sung, prayers prayed, offerings that are given. Lord, as we spend time in your word, I pray that Jesus would be exalted. And we ask that the Holy Spirit would just be strong and mighty in the hearts and lives of men and women and boys and girls. That, Lord, where conviction is needed, you would send your Spirit with conviction. Where encouragement is needed, you would send your Spirit with encouragement. Where direction is needed, you would send your Holy Spirit with direction. God, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit and just ask that he would be mighty in our midst today. God, thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship you. Meet with us here. Lord, give us hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth. Hearts that desire to worship you alone because you are worthy of worship. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, oh, earth is wonderful.
Praise him, praise him.
joyful song. Praise Him, praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals, loud with hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown Him, crown Him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the world victorious. Heaven pure His forever and evermore. Praise Him, praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, praise Him, ever in joyful song.
God, as we look to our world, there is much uncertainty. God, with upcoming elections, with war and strife, with just moral decay within our society, God, there are many things that can cause great concern, that are burdens to us. And a lot of times, God, those burdens, when we don't bring them to You, when we don't see them in the right perspective, God, a lot of times those burdens lead to worry or anger or fear and frustration. They can lead to grumbling and complaining. Lord, forgive us for those times. Your word tells us that we should cast all of our cares on You because You care for us. So Lord, I pray that You would give us a Holy Spirit-guided perspective. Lord, to our world, to our country, to our state, to our community, to our church, to our families, and to our own individual lives. God, I pray that You would give us a perspective of You and Christ seated on the throne, lifted high in majesty, all-powerful, and in control of all things. God, sometimes we don't understand. We don't recognize how You are at work. God, give us eyes of faith. Give us hearts that hope in You. God, just help us to walk with a trust and a confidence that what You say is true. God, within our very own Southern Baptist Convention, we have meetings coming up next week. Lord, there will be votes and there will be business and there will be many things that go on. God, I pray that we would not be distracted by those things, but as a people, as believers, we would recognize that our greatest allegiance is to You and to Jesus Christ. That above all, Lord, our allegiance should align with Your word. God, help Your word to guide us as Southern Baptists. Help Your word to guide us as followers of Christ. Help Your word to guide us as individual believers. God, that we would see Your word as perfect and sufficient to guide and to direct our daily steps and our daily lives. God, forgive us for times that we are not a people of Your word like You desire us to be. Give us a hunger and a thirst for Your word so that, Lord, the seeds of truth of Your word would be planted in our hearts and that they would grow and bear much fruit. God, I pray for our sister churches here within our community. Lord, I pray that You would raise up churches faithful to follow You, faithful to stand and declare and proclaim Your word, faithful to walk in submission to Your word. God, I pray that here on the western side of Stanley County, You would just raise up churches that would impact and influence those around us, that would be beacons of hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we need Your help to do it, but we know that You are able, and we know that You desire for us to be Christ's witnesses here on earth. That's what He told us in the book of Acts. That when He left, the Holy Spirit would come, and the Holy Spirit would bring with Him power to equip us and enable us to be the witnesses that you desire for us to be. So God, I pray that for the church universal. I pray that for local bodies here in our community and all across our nation. God, I pray that for Bethel. God, I pray that for my friends, my brothers and sisters, individuals here at Bethel, that your Holy Spirit would just build and grow within us a faithfulness to reflect Jesus in all that we do and say, and a faithfulness and a willingness to submit to follow you wherever you lead, all for your glory. God, I ask that you would continue to guide and direct in this time of worship this morning, that you would be exalted and glorified. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
There came a sound from heaven. It was like a mighty wind. It filled their hearts with singing and gave them peace within. The prophet gave this promise. He said, the Spirit will descend, and from your inner being a river with no that frees the soul from sin. Come to this water, for there is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry. There came drawing from a well. You see, her life was ruined and wasted, and her soul was bound for hell. But then she met the Master, who told her of her great sin. He said, if you just drink from this water, you will never thirst again. There is a river that flows from deep within. There is a fountain that frees the soul from sin. For there is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry.
Thank you, Renee. This morning, Renee asked me, she said, I'm torn on two songs. What do you think? And I said, hey, that song right there is directly from the text, Where We Are. I said, would you sing that one? And she said, absolutely. If you have your Bible, turn to the book of John, chapter 4. Talked about a woman who was at the well. I love a phrase in that song. The lines say, come to this water. There is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry. That's what Jesus teaches this morning. We introduced this chapter in this text last week, looking to how unconventional and how unexpected Christ and his ministry could be. Jesus wasn't bound by social expectations. Remember, it was a huge taboo for Jews to interact with Samaritans. They were seen as half-breeds, as unclean, impure. So even to be around Samaritans or to eat food that they had prepared or share utensils, it was a huge taboo for the Jewish people. So it speaks volumes when Jesus went against conventional expectation. And we saw that he began to have this conversation with this woman from Samaria at a well. Today we're going to get into the heart of this conversation. So if you have your Bible to John chapter 4, if you would stand with me this morning, I'm going to begin reading in John chapter 4, verse 5, and we'll read through verse 14. John chapter 4, verse 5. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. It was about noon, middle of the day. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria, for Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Verse 10, Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. God, I pray that this morning the truth of your word would just be strong, that God, Jesus, would produce within us and continue to produce within us that living water that he speaks of here in this text. God, as we get into this conversation between Jesus and not only a Samaritan, but a woman at that, is so unconventional and unexpected. Help us to learn from Christ and his interactions and his teachings. Lord, help us to reflect Jesus in the way that he served and loved and spoke and interacted. Help us to reflect him in all that we do and say. Help us to faithfully follow you and to follow Christ's example. God, I pray that Jesus would supply in us that living water today. God, we can often be thirsty for many things, but help our thirst to be quenched exclusively by Jesus Christ. All for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So the first couple of verses, the first few verses in this text from verses 7 to 9, they just serve as a reminder that this setting was absolutely absurd. I mean, it was unheard of that Jesus was speaking with a Samaritan woman at a well in public at midday. But not only that, it speaks to Christ's request for water. All right, he asked this woman to give him water, to provide for him water. We see the humanity of Christ right here. Christ has been on a journey. It's in the heat of the middle of the day, and he's weary. He's thirsty. All right, some people would say that, you know, Jesus was fully God, but they kind of reject that Jesus was fully man at the same time. Right here's evidence from God's word that Christ was hungry and thirsty, just like we are. It's different than our humanity, though, because Christ didn't set aside his deity. It's hard to understand and hard to comprehend, but Jesus, at the same exact time, was fully God and fully man. All right, we can see both sides of that truth here in this text. We get to another example of a conversation that Jesus has here, to where true communication is not taking place. All right, in order for true communication to take place, something has to be communicated clearly, but it also needs to be received. It needs to be heard. All right, there's got to be a transfer of information or communication. But often when Jesus communicated during his ministry, Jesus would be speaking on a spiritual plane and mankind would be hearing on an earthly plane. You know, we can see several examples of that already in the book of John. Think about when Jesus came and cleansed the temple. And then the Jews asked, what right do you have to cleanse the temple in this way? And Jesus said, hey, tear down this temple and I'll build it again in 3 days. They said, hang on, we've been working on building this temple for 46 years and you're going to rebuild it in 3 days? But then John gives a little parenthetical aside. He says, but then we realized later on that he was talking about his body. He was talking about himself, the center of worship. All right, we see another example to where the communication just didn't happen between Jesus and Nicodemus. Nicodemus comes and he says, I kind of understand things about God, and you must be a prophet or a teacher sent from God. Jesus said, in order to truly understand the things of God, you must be born again. On a spiritual level, Jesus says, you've got to be born from the Spirit, a birth from above. Nicodemus asks the question, am I supposed to return to my mom's womb and be born a second time? All right, Jesus is speaking on the spiritual, and people are hearing with their own understanding on the earthly. Another example right here with the woman at the well, when Christ says, hey, will you give me a drink? The communication really doesn't take place, and we see that as we continue on. She said, hey, this is strange. This is odd. What are you doing? I want to pause for just a moment. I think it's important for us. We see, we know Jesus, all right? We have the full revelation of God in Scripture. So it can be easy for us to look at those Jews or to look at Nicodemus or to look at this woman at the well and just be like, they just don't get it. But do you know, we're all that way. None of us get it unless the Lord opens our eyes to where we can see and understand spiritual truth. We all need that work of the Holy Spirit within us. That work of God is the only reason that we are able to understand and receive Christ and to see the things that he teaches, to know that they are true. So I can be quick to look at those people and be like, good grief, there are some dense people. But do you know what? When I look in the mirror, apart from the grace of God and the work of the Holy Spirit in my life, I am a dense person as well. This is another example of that type of conversation. Verse 10, Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. So Jesus right here introduces a couple of ideas. He introduces the gift of God, which he describes as living water. But we know that the gift of God is salvation, all right? It's forgiveness of sin. It is a right and restored relationship with him. We know that it is the promise of eternal life. And Jesus here explains that relationship and that salvation as living water. Jesus also says to this lady at the well, he says, hey, if you knew who you were talking to, all right, and that's not really a derogatory thing. He's not looking down his nose at her, but there's almost this, Christ has this understanding. He's like, you don't know who I am. Did you ever watch that show that used to be on TV years ago called Undercover Boss? All right, the first few seasons of that, I loved, because there were bosses that of large corporations and large businesses that would dress up in a disguise and they would go undercover and work menial jobs within their business just to get feedback from employees and to see what the conditions were really like. I loved it when there were times that employees would open their mouths and stick their foot in their mouth not knowing who they were talking to. I would be like, hey, if you only knew who you were talking to, he's the boss, he has authority, he has power to have you fired this moment. Jesus wouldn't fire this lady, but it was that way. She didn't recognize who Jesus was. She didn't know that he was the Messiah. And Jesus is saying, hey, if you only knew in this moment the power and authority that I have, you'd have come and you'd have asked me for living water. I love how that kind of plays out here again. But we're reminded as we hear the lady's response beginning in verse 11 that this conversation is just on a whole completely, totally different plane from one another. Verse 11, the woman said to him, sir. This is a term of respect, okay? It's not, doesn't really exalt him a lot, but she's being polite. She says, sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. All right, when Jacob dug this well, and here in Christ's day and time of ministry, the well was probably 100 feet deep or more. All right, it was a deep well. So she's looking at him and she's trying to size him up. And she says, what do you have to even be able to draw water? You don't have a bucket. You don't have anything else, any other container, any other vessel. How are you even going to be able to bring this water up? So that was the first issue that she had with Jesus. And now we're going to see again. She says, sir, you have nothing to draw water with and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? And here's her other and even greater statement, her issue that she has with what Christ had just told her. Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well. He drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. All right, Jacob dug this well. He needed something to draw the water up. So she's saying, you don't have anything to draw it up. Jacob did. He had something to draw it up. Are you saying that you're greater than Jacob is? It points us to just the sheer esteem that the Jewish people placed on their forefathers, on the patriarchs, especially Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. All right, this is Jacob's well, Abraham's grandson, all right, that dug this well and provided it. His family used it. His livestock drank water from it. She's looking at this Jewish man that's walking through town, tired and weary in the middle of the day. He has no way to draw water. And she says, are you greater than Jacob? The implication here is she is skeptical. You know, I don't know if it's sarcastic or not, but you can see how it's pointed and direct. And this is a rhetorical question, but it's implied that Jesus is not greater than Jacob. So, who are you? Jacob drank from this well. Jesus responds to her in verses 13 and 14. We see Jesus starting to draw a comparison between the water that he offers and the water of this well that Jacob dug. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life. So here in this comparison, Jesus begins talking about Jacob's well and how the satisfaction or relief that Jacob's well brings is only temporary. It only lasts for a season. Jesus says, hey, you draw this water and drink of it, you're going to be thirsty again and again and again and again. It's an unquenchable thirst. You have that desire for your thirst to be quenched. But with this water, it's only temporary. It's only for a moment, and it still leaves you in great need. It reminded this woman at the well of her physical limitations. On our side, seeing and knowing the story and knowing who Christ is, it is still a reminder of physical limitations that we have as mankind. We'll continue to be physically thirsty again and again and again. That can be a little bit discouraging, you know, to think about how our bodies and our lives are imperfect. We have to return to food and water to sustain us. But Jesus tells this woman at the well that he can provide a water that is completely and totally different. Instead of having to return over and over and over, Jesus provides a water that once and for all satisfies the thirst that she has. You know, that's kind of an interesting thought or topic. You've heard of the fountain of youth, you know, or holy water, or different, you know, special healing waters in different places. I mean, there's a fascination with water and the effects that it can produce. Jesus is saying, hey, I've got a water that I'm going to give you that's unlike any other water anywhere else, because it is sufficient to meet the need that you have. I love the phrasing that Jesus uses as he says, you'll never be thirsty again. And then he describes that water that he'll give to her. He says, the water that I will give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. This idea and thought of living water, it was used in that day of like flowing water. In the very arid and dry climate, a lot of times people would dig out ponds or cisterns around their house to collect rain, all right? The running water supply was limited. But Jacob's well was fed underground by a stream, all right? It was clean and fresh water. It wasn't just stagnant sitting in a pool. So I'm sure as Christ uses the phrasing of this living water, the woman thought, well, of course it's living water because it is moving. It's not just a dugout hole in the ground. You know, it's a well that produces fresh water. But Jesus says that it's a water that will spring up water from inside. Welling up, this word used and translated for welling up, in my mind, as I read welling up, I think of like maybe a little spring on your property that turns into a creek that just kind of bubbles up from under the ground, all right? Where I grew up across the road, my grandfather owned that property, and there's kind of a swampy area, but there's a spring from underground that just water bubbles up, and you can go and you can see where it comes out. But welling up, the word used here in Scripture is not just a bubbling up of a spring. I want to read to you another place in Scripture where a very similar word for welling up is used. It's a passage that you'll be familiar with from Acts chapter 3. Peter and John were going to the temple, and as they were on their way to the temple, there was a man who was lame since birth, who was sitting there outside the temple, and he was begging and asking for money, asking for people to help and assist him. All right? This is Peter's response in Acts 3, beginning in verse 6. Peter said, "I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. Here's the word for welling up. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping in praise. All right? When Jesus says, "I will give you a living water that within you will produce springs that well up," he's not talking about just like a bubbling trickle. Jesus says, "I will give you an overflowing fountain." He says, "I will give you a geyser." Think about geysers that you see out in Yellowstone and out west. I mean, they are forceful. They can be violent, but they are powerful and strong. Jesus says, "Hey, I'm not just going to give you a bubbling spring, but the water that I will give you will build and grow within you a spring of life." It's like a geyser. It overflows. It's very powerful. As we think about this text, we've seen the meat of this text. We've seen the truth that Jesus teaches. On our side of the cross, we understand the disconnect between the water of Jacob's well and the water, the living water that Jesus Christ offers. All right? We can see that. We know that Jesus wasn't talking about drawing water up from the well. He was speaking to this woman's spiritual state and her spiritual need. Why did Jesus have this conversation with the woman at the well? I was thinking about that this past week. Why did Jesus have this conversation? Why did John record it? What can we learn from it? And how can we apply it to our lives today? I think there are some truths that we see as Jesus interacts with this woman at the well, things that Jesus addresses. All right, maybe not directly, but we can see it pretty clearly. The first thing that Christ addresses with this woman, and it applies to our life as well, is that Jesus knows what is in the heart of man. Jesus knows that when we have need, we often try to go about the work of our own hands to bring about the satisfaction or the provision that we need, to bring about the contentment that we desire or the security Jesus knows that we can turn to the work of our hands. We think, well, if I work a little bit more and make a little bit more money, or if I try a little bit harder, or if I'm a little bit nicer to people, or maybe I'm too nice to people, maybe I don't need to be as nice. And we rely upon our thoughts, our direction, our work. Let me read to you a verse from Jeremiah. Isaiah will be in a minute. From Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 13. God says, "For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters." Did you catch that? God describes himself as a fountain, a geyser of living waters. God says, I've got two things against my people. They've rejected me, and that he is the fountain of living water. But listen to this second part. They've forsaken me and have hewed out cisterns for themselves. By the work of their own hands, they have tried to meet their needs. They have tried to bring and find their own satisfaction by the work of their own hands, by their own efforts. Let me finish that verse. Have hewed out cisterns for themselves, broken cisterns that can hold no water. The woman at the well was hanging her hat on her forefathers, and that was Jacob's well. Jacob even drank from it himself. Surely that gives a little bit of goodness and extra blessing on me. We can think, well, I do these things and I work in this way trying to earn satisfaction or comfort, to find relief, to find God's favor. And God says, when you do things in your own effort, you're just digging out cisterns to hold and collect stagnant water. But they don't even do that. They're broken and they won't even hold water at all. The heart of man desires satisfaction. There's something that we long for, that we desire. There are things that we look toward and work for. It might be different for some of us, but some of those things are success, comfort, a good paying job so that we can provide for ourselves and our families. All right, we look for happiness and a lack of strife within our lives. A lot of times I find myself guilty in trying to produce and bring those things about myself. And when I look to those things for satisfaction, God says, your efforts are only creating empty, busted, broken cisterns that will never be able to hold water. They will never be able to provide what you're looking for. That's hard. That's tough. Even though I have surrendered my life to Jesus Christ, there are times where I want to take back over the wheel and I want to captain my own ship. I want to have a hand and a say in the path of my life and what happens in my life. But my plans are broken cisterns. Jesus is teaching this woman at the well that he alone can satisfy. We're challenged by this truth as well. The second part that we see here is a lot more gracious. Christ knows what's within us, but Christ is teaching her that he alone can satisfy her need. He alone can satisfy her desires. I don't want to jump too far ahead. You're familiar with this story. This woman has had multiple husbands, and the guy that she's currently living with is not her husband. Okay, we're going to get to that. She is looking and searching and seeking. Maybe for love, maybe for provision, maybe for comfort, satisfaction. She is looking. And Jesus is teaching this lady here in this moment, in this conversation, that he alone can satisfy her desires and what she's looking for. Back to Isaiah chapter 55, I want to read you some verses. It says, "Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters." So again, this idea and thought of thirst being quenched by water. "Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. So do you get that? The invitation is to come to the waters. That we have nothing that can purchase or we can use in a transaction for these waters. We come broken. We come empty. It says, come and buy without money and without price. Why would you spend your money for that which is not bread and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Why do you go to other things looking for that satisfaction? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good and delight yourselves in rich food. Here you go. Incline your ear and come to me here that your soul may live. That's what we're talking about. That's what Jesus is telling the woman at the well. You may look and search for and seek after the work of your own hands. All right? You may try to invest in things that you believe will meet your needs and quench the holes and emptiness in your life. But Jesus says, when you work on your own, it's a broken cistern. They will never satisfy. You will find yourself coming back again and again and again. Over and over and over. But in Jesus, when we turn to Him and we look to Him for our satisfaction, for our purpose, for our meaning, for our worth, when we look to Him to meet the needs and the emptiness that we have, the things that we search for in so many different places, when we turn to Jesus and we look to Him, Jesus meets those needs, not just a little bit. But He says that He becomes living water, that geyser. It reminds me of John 10:10 that we'll get to later on. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life. But He doesn't stop right there. He says, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it abundantly. Much. That's not talking about possessions, but that's talking about Jesus meeting every single need that we have. Jesus is teaching this lady truths that are still applicable and true for us 2,000 years later. We still need to hear this message that ultimate and true satisfaction can only be found in Jesus Christ. Because when we look for it in other places, we're just looking in busted up, dug out holes in the ground that are empty. Be challenged by this conversation. We have much to learn. But remember, we're going through John, considering what it means to reflect Jesus and faithfully follow Him. What do we see about reflecting Jesus in this text? What do we see about faithfully following Him in this text? Friends, every single one of us in this room know many people, whether it's family or friends or coworkers or neighbors or breakfast buddies, we all know somebody who's running on that hamster wheel trying to find satisfaction, trying to find something to meet their needs, something that brings contentment. They don't realize that they're running on a hamster wheel. But that's what Jesus says. Jesus says, you will be thirsty again. You will continue to come back. Friends, we know that Jesus is living water, that He is sufficient to meet needs and to quench thirst spiritually. There's no other way to meet that need. Friends, we know people that are caught up in that rat race of trying to look and find and seek satisfaction, to find purpose and meaning in things outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ. Friends, have you trusted in Jesus today? If you have, Jesus says within you is a well, a geyser of eternal life, of security and salvation. Do you know what Christ has called us to do as the church? He has called us to be His witnesses. So when we cross paths with those family members and friends and others in our path, the Holy Spirit lays it on our heart, we can say, Hey, you may be searching. You may be seeking. You may be pursuing and working toward. But let me tell you about a different way. Let me tell you about Jesus Christ, who provides a living water so that you will never thirst again. There are people all around us every day that are searching for hope, that their life seems hopeless. There are people who are seeking relief or a way to be able to cope with difficult circumstances of life, tragedy. Friends, we know that it produces a never-ending thirst. But friends, we know the source of living water. Fountains, geysers of water. Jesus says, if you just knew who I was. Friends, we know. We should share and tell. It's what he's called us to do. Let us be faithful in doing so. God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the truth of your word. God, I thank you for this conversation that Jesus had, that he and this woman, they weren't on the same page. But God, when we really look at it, we can relate to this woman at the well. We can just be thinking with our own wisdom in an earthly terms. But when we do, we miss what you try to teach us. We miss what Christ was trying to teach her. God, we're all guilty of running after and digging out cisterns for ourselves. Lord, forgive us. Convict us. Help us to neglect and turn our back on our own efforts, our own cisterns, because they're just busted and broken anyway. God, as we have great need within our lives and we look to meet it and fulfill it, sometimes in many different ways, help us to be reminded of Christ and his teaching, that he produces a living water that meets our spiritual need. But that need that Jesus meets is not just a spiritual need for all eternity. Christ said that he came so that we could have abundant life now. That's what Paul reminds us of, that daily we need to be crucified with Christ so that it's not us who live, but Christ lives through us. Christ desires to be that living water in our life every day. Lord, help us to surrender to those truths. God, I pray that your word would do a great work in the hearts and lives of your people here at Bethel. God, I pray that your work would do a great work in my own heart and life. God, help us to find our ultimate satisfaction in the living water of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.